Hello friends, the topic for today is 80386 signal description part 1. 80386 features a straightforward functional interface to the external hardware. The 80386 has separate parallel buses for data and address. A dynamic data bus sizing feature allows the processor to handle a mix of 32 and 16 bit external buses on cycle by cycle basis. A new address pipelining option is provided and applies to 32 bit and 16 bit buses for substantially improved memory utilization. The 80386 bus cycles perform data transfer in a minimum of only 2 clock periods. In today's video, you will learn the signal description of 80386 microcursor part 1. The remaining part of signal description will be covered in the next video, and the bus cycles will be covered in the later videos. Let us start. Welcome to our channel Engineering and Technology for You. If you are not subscribed to our channel, kindly subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon so that you get the notifications for future videos. The topic for today is 80386 signal description part 1. Let us start with the functional data introduction. The 80386 features a straightforward functional interface to the external hardware. The 386 has separate parallel buses for data and address. There is no multiplexing. Then data bus is 32 bit in width and bidirectional. The address bus outputs 32-bit address values in the most directly usable form for high-speed local bus. 4 individual byte-enabled signals and 30 upper-order bits as binary values. So, A2 to A31, 30 bits are given by 80386. The data and address buses are interpreted and controlled with their associated control signals. There are signals for controlling the data and address buses. Let us see the signals after some time. The dynamic data bus sizing feature allows the processor to handle a mix of 32 and 16 bit external buses on a cycle by cycle basis. So we can use the data bus of 32 bit or 16 bit. Then a new address pipelining option is provided and applies to 32 bit and 16 bit buses for substantially improved memory utilization, especially for most heavily used memory resources. So this pipelining option will say it will add to the improvement in the memory utilization. Then 80386 bus cycle perform data transfer in a minimum of only 2 clock periods. So that will improve the speed of the processor. Then let us go to the signal description introduction. A brief description of 80386 input and output signals arranged by functional groups is given here. The hash symbol at the end of the signal name indicates the active or asserted state occurs when the signal is at a low voltage. So, those signals which are active low, they will be represented with a hash symbol at the end of the signal. When no hash is present after the signal name, the signal is asserted when at the high voltage. So that will be active high. For example, here MIO hash. See, a high voltage indicates memory selected and a low voltage indicates IO selected. So this is similar to MIO bar signal. So So there is no bar, instead of that they represented with the hash. Then let us go to the functional signal groups. Here you can see the 80386 processor. We have the clock 2 signal. So this is the clock 2 signal, which is input signal. And then we have the data bus D0 to D31, that is 32-bit data bus. And there is the address bus is separate. Here we are showing A2 to A31, 30 upper bits of the address bus. And these are the BE0 to BE3, these are the byte enables signals. So that will constitute the 32-bit address bus. Then we have the bus control signals here, ADS, NA, BS16 and READY. And bus cycle definitions, W, R, D, C, M, I, O and LOG. And all these are ending with the hash. So these are the signals which we are going to study in today's video. The other signals, that is bus arbitration, that is hold HLDA, then coprocessor signaling, this PREQ BZ error, then interrupts INTR, NMI, reset and power connections. These signals will study in the next video. We start with the clock 2. Now, clock 2 provides the functional timing for the 80386. It is divided by 2 internally to generate the internal processor clock used for instruction execution. So, there is a, it is internally divided by 2. So, this clock 2 will be having frequency which will be the clock frequency multiplied by 2. The internal clock is comprised of 2 phases. Phase 1 and phase 2. Each clock 2 period is a phase of the internal clock. If desired, the phase of the internal processor clock can be synchronized to the known phase of by ensuring the reset signal following edge meets the application setup and hold times, that is T25 and T26. Then let us go see the diagram. This is the internal 80386 processor clock, same frequency as 82384 clock signal. So this is the clock generator compatible with the 80386. So this is the clock, and this clock 2 here, it has 2 phases, phase 1, phase 2. So the frequency will be, say, twice of the clock. Then let us see the data bus. This tri-state bidirectional signals provide the general purpose data path between 80386 and other devices. Data bus inputs and outputs indicate 1 when high. The data bus can transfer data on 32 and 16-bit buses using a data bus sizing feature controlled by BS16 hash input. This is the signal which will control the bus sizing feature. Then data bus reads requires that read data setup and hold times T21 and T22 be met for the correct operation. So these are the timing specifications given by the manufacturer. And during any write operation and during the halt cycles and shutdown cycles, the 80386 always drive all 32 signals of the data bus, even if the current bus size is 16 bits. So during any write operation or halt and shutdown cycles, so it will drive the all the 32 signals of the data bus, even if the size is 16 bit. Then let us go to the next signal, that is the address bus. Here, when we are discussing the address bus, we have A2 to A31 and BE0 hash to BE3 hash. These three state output provides physical memory addresses or IO port addresses. The address bus is capable of addressing 4 gigabytes of physical memory space, 2 raised to 32. So this is nothing but we are having 8 zeros here, that is representing the 32 bits. So this 000 to FFFF, that is the total size of the memory space, and 64 kilobytes of the IO address space. So that will be here, it will start from, say we are showing it in 32 bit, so it will end here up to FFFF for programmed IO. Then IO transfers automatically generated for 80386 to coprocessor communication use IO addresses. Now here, these are the addresses for the coprocessor, 800000F8 through 800000FF. So F8 to FF, those are the addresses in the 8086. Similarly, only this represented in the 32 bit. So A31 high in conjunction with MIO bar hash low allows simple generation of the coprocessor select signal. So A31 is high here because the address is starting with 8000. So that will be 1 here. Then the byte enable outputs BE hash B3 hash directly indicate which byte of the 32 bit data bus are involved with the current transfer. This is most convenient for external hardware. So BE0 hash applies to D0 to D7, then BE1 hash applies to D8 to D15, BE2 hash applies to D16 to D23, and BE3 hash applies to D24 to D31. So these are the 4 bytes, or we can say 32 bit of the data. Then the number of bytes enabled asserted indicate the physical size of the operand being transferred. So if you are just making 1, it will be 1, 2, 3 or 4 bytes. So we will make use of this byte enable outputs BE0 hash to BE3 hash for the transfer of data. Then write data duplication. When a memory write cycle or IO write cycle is in progress and the operand being transferred occupies only the upper 16 bits of the data bus, that is D16 to D31. Duplicate data is simultaneously present on the corresponding lower order 16 bits of the data bus D0 to D15. So that is called as the data duplication. This duplication is performed for optimum write performance on the 16 bit buses. So for that purpose only this duplication is carried out. The pattern of write data duplication is a function of byte enable asserted during the write cycle. So here we have table 1 that lists the write data present on the, say, D0 to D31 as a function of the asserted byte enable outputs B0 to B3. Let us see the table. So you can see here D0 to D31, these are the 80386 write data bytes, and then 80386 byte enables. So BE0 BE1, BE2 and BE3. So when BE0 is low, then data will transfer on this, say D0 to D7, that we are shown it here A. So you can see logical write data D0 to D7, A represents that. Then when this BE1 is low, then the data will travel on these lines D8 to D15. So here we have shown B. Then BE2 is low, the data will travel here D16 to D23. And when BE3 hash is low, it will travel on this D24 to D31. So this is how the data will travel on the data bus depending on the byte enabled signals. So at a time, so here when we want 16 bit data, we can make these two low. So this A and B, so it will, the data will travel on this byte as well as this byte. So it will be D0 to D15. Then when we want all the, when all are low, then D, C, B, A, so 32-bit data can be transferred. So at that time, there will be no duplication. Whereas here, for the 16-bit data, we can, when it is traveling on the higher order bus, see here, D, C, here, there will be duplication of data. There is the duplication of data. So then, let us go to the bus cycle definition signals, WR hash, DC hash, MIO hash and lock hash. These three state output define the type of bus cycle being performed. WR hash distinguishes between write and read cycle. So just like we have the WR bar and read bar. So here only we have one signal, W/R hash. So when it is high, it will write. When it is low, it will read. Then D/C hash, distinguishes between data and control cycles. Then MIO hash, distinguishes between memory and IO cycles. Then lock hash, distinguishes between locked and unlocked bus cycles. So this four signals will distinguish between the different things. The primary bus cycle definition signals, WR hash, DC hash and MIO hash, since they are the signals driven valid as the ADS hash, that is address status output, is driven asserted. So they are depending on this address status output. And the lock hash is driven valid at the same time as the first lock bus cycle begins, which is due to the address pipelining, could be later than ADS hash is driven asserted. The lock hash is negated when the ready hash input terminates the last bus cycle, which was locked. So exact bus cycle definitions as function of WR hash, DC hash and MIO hash are given in table. So you can see again in the table the details. So MIO hash, DC hash and WR hash. So when all the three are low, it is the interrupt acknowledge cycle and it will be locked. Then when this is low and this is high. So it does not occur. Low, high, low. See, here this is low means it is IO. Then this is high, it means it is the data cycle. And this is low means it is the read. So that's why we get IO data read. Similarly, when this is low, that means it is IO. When this is high, it means it, again it is data. And this is high means it is write. So it is the IO data write. Then similarly here, it is high. Now high means it is for the memory, then low it is for the data, and again here low that is for read. So memory code read, it is similar to the phase cycle. Then high, low, high. Now this high, low, high, that is for halt or shutdown depending on the particular, say, byte enables. So both are high here, this is low and this is high. And again similarly here, the address is 0 for shutdown and halt. So those write cycles which we have discussed earlier. Then this is high, high and low. So this is for memory, that is again data, and low here means it is the read. So memory data read. Then high, high, high. So that will be memory data write. So this is how the bus cycle definition we take from the MIO hash, DC hash and WR hash, these three signals. Then let us go to the bus control signals. Here the bus control signals, the following signals allow the processor to indicate when the bus cycle has begun and allow other system hardware to control address pipelining, data bus width and bus cycle termination. So here the first signal is address status, ADS hash. This tri-state or three-state output indicates that a valid bus cycle definition and address is WR hash, DC hash, IO ember hash, B0 hash, 2B3 hash and A2 to A31 is being driven at 80386 pins. It is asserted during T1 and T2 bus cycles. So that is the address status. So it is similar to the address latch enable. The functionality will be similar to that. Then let us go to the next, transfer acknowledge, that is the ready signal. This input indicates that current bus cycle is complete and the active bytes indicated by B0 hash and B3 hash and BS16 are accepted or provided. So when read hash is sampled asserted during read cycle or interrupt acknowledge cycle, the 80386 latches the input data and terminates the cycle. Now when ready is sampled asserted during a write cycle, the processor terminates the bus cycle. Then the ready hash is ignored on the first bus state of the all bus cycles and sampled each bus state thereafter until asserted. So this signal will change as per the status. So ready must eventually be asserted to acknowledge every bus cycle, including the halt indication, shutdown indication, bus cycles. So when being sampled, ready must be always made up the hold times T19 and T20 for correct operation. So the basic function of ready is we have to sample the ready signal for the read cycle, then for the other cycle, write cycle, and depending on the whether it is high or low, the action will take place. Then next address request, NA hash. This is used to request address pipelining. This input indicates the system is prepared to accept the new values of B0 hash to B3 hash, A2 to A31, WR, DC and MIO from the 80386, even if the end of the current cycle is not being acknowledged on the radio. So if this input is asserted when sampled, the next address is driven into the bus, provided the next bus request is ready pending internally. So this is used for request address pipelining. So address is being pipelined here So for that, the system is prepared to accept new values of the, say, byte enabled signals, then addresses, then the different signals WR, DC and MIO from 386, even if the end of the current cycle is not being acknowledged. So that's why it will be in pipeline. The next is bus size 16. So BS 16 hash. The BS 16 hash feature allows 80386 directly to connect to 32-bit and 16-bit data buses. Asserting this input constrains the current bus cycle to use only the lower order, that is lower order half, D0 to D15 of the data bus corresponding to BE0 hash and BE1 hash. So this BE0 hash and BE1 hash, they correspond to the lower two bytes, D0 to D7 and D8 to D15. So asserting BS16 has no additional effect if only B0 hash and BE1 hash are asserted in the current cycle. However, during bus cycle asserting, B2 hash and B3 hash asserting B16 will automatically cause the 8036 to make adjustment to correct the transfer of the upper bytes using only physical data signals D0 to D15. So this is what it will adjust the transfer of upper bytes of the data using the physical data signals D0 to D15. So if the operand spans both half of the data bus, that is BS16 is asserted, the 8036 automatically perform another 16-bit bus cycle. So BS16 must always meet up and hold times T16 and T18, sorry, for the correct operation. So the bus size 16, it is allows the 80386 to directly connect to a 32-bit and 16-bit data buses. So depending on the enable bits, it will do the functionality. Then let us come to the summary of the signals which we have learned today. So table 3 summarizes the characteristics of all the 80386 signals which we have learned today. So first is the clock 2, that is the signal function is clock, and it is the input signal. Then D0 to D31, that is the data bus, the active state is high. And it is both input output, it is bidirectional. And input sync or async, yes. Then BE0 hash to BE3 hash, these are the byte enables. So they are, say, ending with hash, so they are active loop. And their output. Then A2 to A31, that is the address bus. So active again high, and it is only the output signal, okay, unidirectional. Then here this output high impedance during HLDA, yes, all the buses are tri-stated. So then WR write read indication, that is again, say, if it is high, it will be using the write, if it is low, it is for the read operation, it is the output signal. Then DC is the data control indication. Then MIO is the memory IO indication. Again the similar function it is. Then lock, bus lock indication, low, active state is low because it is, and it will it is the output signal. Then address status ADS, and NA is the next address request, that is for the address pipelining. Then BS16, bus size 16, that is for the 32 as well as the 16 data bus. Then ready transfer acknowledge. That is the functionality. Again, it is active low. So with this, we come to the end of the signals description. If you have any questions, you can contact me on Facebook, Twitter, Gmail or Instagram. Then if you like the video, press the like button, share with your friends and subscribe to our channel Engineering and Technology for You, and press the bell icon if you want to get the upcoming videos. Thanks for watching. Have a nice day.